Custodial Reform Committee. I'm here today as an associate of FAW to support a bill that is very close and personal to my heart. So I want to start by thanking our representatives Wolf, Hartzell, and Jones, and members of the various organizations that are here today, including Maternal Guardians of Iowa, Americans for Equal Shared Parenting, and Leading Women for Shared Parenting, just to name a few wonderful groups that FAW has developed relationships with. And I'd also like to thank our association for joining us today, and all others, both in favor and in opposition to SF 2374. The health and happiness of Iowa's children are most important to us all, despite our strong feelings and differing experiences. Those speaking in favor today have diverse backgrounds. Some, such as myself, represent the intentions of Families United Action Network. Some represent other organizations, and still others represent no group at all, just their personal interests. Issues of family law are intensely and emotionally charged, so I ask anyone speaking today to please only do so if you are committed to respecting others and working together for the betterment of Iowa's children. Don't let another generation of kids grow up with holes in their hearts, missing half of their families. Don't let another generation of kids become prizes to be won in a war where they can only lose. It's time that we shift from putting parental interests first and start doing what's truly best for the child, and SF 2374 will accomplish that. I urge our legislators to move forward and pass the rebuttable presumption for equal shared parenting bill so that the next generation of Iowa's children who must endure a divorce or separation can maintain strong and familiar bonds that will benefit them for a lifetime. Thank you.
I'm here to raise one founder of Family United Action Network. I would just encourage, I would like to thank everybody, both the opposition and the legislators for taking the time, as well as members who have driven all the way across the state. This is an issue that really can affect every facet of life by helping to balance the family. That might always, you know, this might be split, but you're still a family when you have a child together, and there needs to be levels of for that child. And when we put that child truly first, I believe that we will see that ripple out into several other aspects of it, our schools, our economy, everywhere.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Joy Johnson. I'm from the People's United Action Network. We deal specifically with all kinds of aspects of children's mental health, and we definitely think that not forcing a child to choose which parent is more important, nor having a court decide which parent is more important in a child's life, is the best way to definitely address the issue. The reality of the great bill, I don't think that anything is lost by using this procedure. It's basically a requirement that the judge look at these things and take into account these types of issues before deciding who's a fit and a parent, or to encourage upon a parent's parenting time with their children. And so I think that this is a great way to do that. I also definitely think that we don't lose anything. I think that it definitely adds more protections to the child's mental and emotional well-being.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Dr. Bruce Peterson. I'm here personally, and I'd like to offer a little bit of professional insight as well. On a personal level, I have been affected by this two sons, as a physician, I am also, it's my responsibility to pick up on when I notice changes in individuals' behaviors. And with being with patients for a prolonged amount of time, you do get to know them. I have picked up numerous times when I have seen children, adolescents, who have not previously actually reached out to anybody. They do trust me, and we do end up talking. There is a common theme that I've seen, and it is that the two parents have separated or divorced and are fighting. Now, that may be inevitable regardless with divorce or separation. However, it's often brought up that one of the children feels as though the other parent does not want them to see the other parent. The children begin to internalize this, and they begin to feel as though it's their fault. This, for me, is absolutely heartbreaking. It's something that I never want to see my children have to go through, to to a doctor that they trust. I would also like to mention a psychologist by the name of Dr. Linda Nielsen has issued, she's the leading researcher from Wake Forest. She has compiled 60 different articles in an unbiased manner in regard to the shared versus solo parenting. And conclusively across the board, it has been found despite the level of animosity between the parents, which is nearly inevitable, that it is still in the child's best interest to see both parents equally. When they are below 35% is the number that she found, then it is an extraordinary detriment to the well-being and the growth of the child. So, thank you very much for your time.
My name is Chad Castell. I'm not with any organization for the first countries. I'm going to be not only a victim of the current legislation, but also as a child, but also as a father now. I grew up where one of my parents alienated myself to the point where I was never able to see one of my other parents. Now, I'm specifically not putting the gender out there because it doesn't matter. The fact of the matter is, one of my parents alienated me against the other. For 5 years, I never saw one of my parents. And then they died. That time is never going to be recovered. And unfortunately, I'm having to deal with that with my own children. I do have every other weekend, so I am fortunate to at least have that. It was a fight. I was deployed multiple times in the Army. When I was divorced, I was stationed at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. When I came home, I got, at first, I got supervised visitation because my daughter was very young. And unfortunately, she brought her here, which I had no contest against. But I came here to be with my child. I fought, and I even built a ramped-up parenting plan that over a year I would develop that relationship and then hopefully we can get into that shared parenting. And of course, that was fought and I lost. I love my child. I'm remarried. I have three beautiful daughters who barely get to know their sister. And this isn't about the fathers or even sometimes the mothers in the room. This is about the children. Who's going to tell my sister, my daughters that they don't get to see their sister very often? I have to explain to my children who are saying this is not fair that I can't see my sister. How do you explain that to a two-year-old and a four-year-old? It's extremely difficult. And I'm also, you know, very passionate about domestic violence. I've seen it growing up. You know, the one that actually won custody abused the other child, or the other parent. And I actually witnessed it with my step-parent as well. Abused my step-parent. And they still had custody. My younger sister was a victim of domestic violence. And I flew her to North Carolina to live with me because I couldn't stand for her to be a victim. So, reading this is a phenomenal bill. This is remarkably better than it was last year. Because last year, I didn't really touch on this as much. And I'm so glad that we have it the way that it's written this year. It is remarkable. And I want to thank everybody who worked hard, Family Action United Network, Senator Garrett, who was a soldier for this bill. I really appreciate it. And of course, you guys here listening to us. Thank you guys so much for everything. And hopefully, we can share the support in this bill.
Hi, thank you for letting me speak. My name is Charles Ledra. I have three different children, so three different unique experiences. One of the unique things, because my children are spread out, I have a 27-year-old son, and the parental alienation that I went through with his mom has carried over to his children because he's now a parent, which makes me a grandparent. So the difficulties that we've had have carried over to that. Now I've seen my grandkids like three times. And you know, it's something I've always wanted to be in their lives. I've always made that like a focus point for them and stuff. But I think just the problems that we've had, and then so it's multi-generational too, because this is my mom, so that's her great grandkids. She doesn't get to see them either because of the same chain reaction that happened all the way back in 1990. That's how long I've been going through this. So 1990 is when I didn't get much back then. Didn't get anything back then ever, except for every other weekend and a Wednesday night, didn't even get to claim my child every other year, tax year, even though I worked and should have been able to do that. So that was the only rights I had. So by the time I got those, my oldest son was already almost into his teenage years. He didn't quite get a good relationship when he was younger, so he didn't want to come over, even though I could have made him come over, but I never wanted him to do that. I didn't want to force him to come over there. So he said he wanted to go out with his friends. You know, I let him, but thinking back, maybe I should have just had him come over, because maybe it wouldn't be as bad as it is now. But every other weekend, 4 days a month, is not enough to influence a child. Well, not enough to instill your values, the assets that you want them to have, you know, the values and just the ideals and stuff. If you have limited contact, how can you ever convey that without, you know, just hammering it down and, you know, this is what you got to do, rather than just let it come naturally, let them learn from you by experience. So, thank you for letting me speak.
My name is Dan Poland, and thank you for allowing us to talk. As my son said, I'm a great grandmother. I'm also a grandmother, and I'm a mother. And I have seen all of this happen time and time again. And the biggest problem I have with parents not being able to start off equal playing children is when a family separates, the child takes it personal as the only way they can. They feel they're being punished because a judge or an attorney or someone decided they really shouldn't see both parents. So they're suffering the loss of their family, their home, their environment, and one of their parents. And the war between the parents inevitably goes on. When do we stop caring more for the children than for the parents? But I realize this is money that's at stake in this whole conversation, but I would give everything to do for these kids. Nurture them, take them places, show them how to live, share my life with them, because my life is their history, and their life is my future. And I do not like that they're told, well, you did something wrong in the right way, you can't say this person or that person, when each time one of my grandchildren was ripped out of our family, I grieve like anybody else. I sit right now in my home, close to foreclosure, because I will do anything it takes to have one more minute, one more child. That's all I ask. It's just a piece to
me. I'm sorry, I just wanted to add one thing. This picture is the only picture I have with all three of my children together. That is the only one. It's on my Facebook profile. I will not change it just because of that fact. My daughter's 10 now. And this is still the only picture I have with all three of my children in the exact same place at the exact same time.
Thank you. I'm Attorney Jeff Jansen. I'm family law attorney here in town. I'm also director of a nonprofit called Safe Families for Children, which we try and help children and family who are in crisis, and it's kind of like a pre-foster care organization. I am in favor of this bill, as I think it is what is in the best interest of the children. As a practicing family law attorney, it is common knowledge among my colleagues that if you get if you get a male client, the majority of the time, you will have to get twice as much of a retainer, spend twice as much money, and do at least twice as much work for that client than if you get a female client. Everybody knows it. Everybody knows that the playing field is not equal. Everybody knows that because of this, it allows for more litigation, more time spent in court, and more money in attorney's pockets. It is against my financial interest to be be in favor of this bill, but I'm not here for my I'm not here for myself having gone through this myself. I'm here for the children and for everyday Iowans because this bill allows for equal prices. Further, there have been ideas floated around by different organizations and groups that domestic violence will increase and will be a big factor in this bill and if this is put in the law. That is an absolute lie. This bill may not ignore domestic violence, but if you look at the one we currently have, it doesn't either. The only thing that may possibly change is with a clear and convincing standard, the judge is allowed to make the determination using clear and convincing evidence. Right now, what they do is a lot of attorneys around the state will make allegations, false allegations of domestic abuse, which undermine actual abuse that's happening in the state, and use that as a tool to get custody for their client. With a clear and convincing standard, there will actually have to be some sort of evidence aside from mere allegations that abuse is happening. And even if there, there is abuse happening, or some things that aren't specifically enumerated in this bill, the judge has the discretion to make that decision that it is not in the best interest of the child or his parents to have the shared parenting. That's why it is a rebuttable presumption. The bar today will talk to you about how they are against this bill. But as a part of the bar, I will tell you, I do not stand with the bar on this topic. The reason, I believe, is that it comes to money. It comes to their pocketbook. And if they would be honest and tell you guys that, I would respect it. But they're going to provide you red herrings and other things that don't apply to throw you off of what their real reason is. With that, I just ask that you would support this.
Thank you. Mr. Jackson, can I just ask a quick question?
Yes.
So under current Iowa code, 5.8.41, a finding by the court that a history of domestic abuse exists does outweigh consideration of any other factor when it comes to ward custody. So I think you said that under current code, domestic violence is not a factor the court
considers. It's a factor the court does consider.
Right.
It's not something that we're not saying that the court can't consider.
Okay.
The bill does not say that the court cannot consider domestic violence.
Okay, I misunderstood. Thank you.
Basically, what is in place all of the fail safes that are there already. So if the judge can do these things, we're not taking anything away from the judge and any of the capabilities that the judge has. We're actually adding to it, and asking the judge to use a fair and reasonable process in determining how to impede upon or encroach upon a parent's time management.
I'm Darren Clark, I'm a father of two children. And, about a month ago, we had planned to pick up the lead in the House representative this morning, but we didn't, so we kind of just kind of need that they have to be here also. I was married for 5 years, and my wife decided to separate, and we did shared parenting for 14 months, and then she filed papers, and then they were just from there, all kinds of like just try to character assassination, fault confessions, and things like that. I just really support this bill. The original intent of a relationship was to raise the kids again and maximum time together. And that's what this bill says. Let's just have an equal playing field, equal access to the kids to their mother and father. Yeah, with all the others. This happens to be their spring break, so they can land us to be out there. Share a number of different things with them, but my time is limited. It's every other weekend. Thursdays and overnight. I saw the damaging effects of what's happening on my kids. My son was having behavioral issues at school, over 100 in the first year when the custody changed. So I started volunteering. My company is gracious enough to let me have Thursday afternoons off. I volunteer in the school system in the classrooms. What's all kind of absurd. Just any extra time I can be with them. The kids are writing letters about, miss you, Daddy, and I can't wait to see you. Here's a woman says on Friday night, just before spring break, I was in the bathroom sobbing. She didn't have any tissues. So I use rolls, toilet paper, used a whole one. It seemed like I cried for an hour. I missed dinner because I was sleeping because of sadness. The force controls your feelings a lot. It can make you mean, lonely or an outside person or a kid. It just twisted my brother's heart. A lot of things it's cool. I get lots of letters. I wish I could have more time. Granted, I can have more time with you. And, you know, Dr. Richard Warshak did a study. He's got a book called Divorce Boys. It says the most scientific studies cited in this review show that children can benefit from joint custody. Even when parents are in conflict, it also makes the point that some conflict between parents is instigated primarily by one parent who seeks to marginalize the other parent's relationship with the child. We just want a bill that can have equal access. To oppose shared parenting is to tell kids that one of their parents' relationship is less important than the other parent. If you oppose it, you're telling your constituents that half of them, their relationship with their child is not as important. Or as a client, you're telling them that half of their relationship kids are the innocent victims of this.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Doug Streicher, on behalf of the Iowa State Bar Association, I'm joined by a couple of colleagues. Just to set the record here, the Iowa State Bar Association is currently registering an opposition to this bill. A couple of claims that have been made, I'm sure my colleagues will address. We are not in the opposition to shared parenting or joint physical custody. As appears to have been implied by comments that were made previously. We're opposed to a piece of legislation that mandates it, if it or not that mandate. It creates a presumption, a rebuttable presumption, driven by clear lines again. We believe the current law drives towards parenting. With that, I'll introduce Diane Kornberg, who's a, I don't want to give up your age, but how many years have you been doing family law?
I've been practicing in Iowa for 40 years doing family law. I've represented men who got custody, men who didn't. I've represented women who got custody, women who didn't. I've represented kids. I'm also a mediator, a parenting coordinator, and one of my advanced trainings as parenting coordinator is in clinical alienation, so I'm trained to screen and identify that. I'm a collaborative lawyer, which means I need collaborative divorce where people commit to solving the cases without court intervention. I've also raised 10 kids who experienced guilt, so I know a little bit about raising kids and what's good for them. As Doug said, we don't disagree that joint physical care can be a good arrangement. In some cases, it is the very best arrangement. And as a guardian ad litem, I have recommended joint physical care for parents who agree. As a lawyer, I have sought joint physical care for dad, sought joint physical care for moms, sought sole physical care, any of your arrangements. It's the presumption that object and presumption substitutes what presumption is for evidence, and what it substitutes for in this bill is a finding of what's in the child's best interest. It would eliminate the child's best interest as a standard and instead impose a presumption that one arrangement is better than all other arrangements for kids. And we disagree that there's any cookie cutter like that is a better arrangement for kids than any other. We think that first the parents should make the decision. And if parents can't make the decision, then a court should make the decision. And when a court makes a decision, it should be based on babies and kids' best interests. A few years ago, we had a couple judges who were very happy in January when they took the family law bench in Polk County and had lots of decrees, lots of final orders where there was joint physical care, and they said, hallelujah, this peace is broken out, all is well. But then they met with us parenting coordinators in March, and they, because people who had this is what's left. And that's a problem. Quiet mind, parenting coordination, Kim. I'm sorry, I didn't quote directly. She said, when we got divorced, we felt guilty. We wanted to keep two kids. We wanted to keep our son pretty much the way it had been. And we wanted to do what was best for him. But then, as time went by, we had new relationships, we had new jobs, and the external forces of new spouses came into play. And new spouses didn't support our co-parenting, and it has just become very difficult. And we're both great parents. Court's not going to give either one of us custody over the other. But now we are stuck with joint physical care. And let me tell you, this family, they were in my office. We were working on a parallel parenting plan. They had 12 goals that they agreed on for their kids. They had 15 values that they agreed on for their kids. And then they spent 20 minutes arguing whether the glitter goes on the dollar bill or on the whole pillow when the tooth fairy comes. And they were bitterly arguing about this. There are criteria now. The Hansen case has a criteria for what should be considered when a court has to decide whether there's joint custody and care or not. These are well researched, and I think Jenny does some additional research on that subject. A rebuttable presumption means that in order to rebut the presumption, you have to go to court. And if you end up in court arguing over custody, it means you have failed in co-parenting. And I won't go into a lot of detail about my graph. I have an article in Great Resource Law that has this explanation. But if you're in court, you have a lot of engagement with each other, with the other parent, and a lot of conflict because you're sitting in a tiny room with a small audience saying every terrible thing you can think of about each other. And then after that, if court says you have joint physical care because there's a presumption, then somehow you have to try and figure out how to co-parent for the next 14 years. After blood is spilled in the courthouse. There are other ways to solve the problems than a presumption for joint physical care. Joint physical care presumption creates problems rather than solves them. I think Jenny may have what will provide you. I did a study of all of the appellate cases in joint physical care from early 2016 to the end of February. And these are just cases that went to appeal. But of the cases, I think it's 57 cases that went to appeal. In 29 cases, the dad either got primary custody or joint physical care. In 28 cases, the mom got custody. The father, there's an unequal playing field. There's simply not the case. It may be in some places with some judges, but overall, the law doesn't create that unequal playing field. There are some problems in family law. One of the problems in family law is the title of the case looks just like a lawsuit, one person versus another person. We had the Supreme Court's task force that addressed family law issues a few years ago, came up with some ideas about how to handle cases better. We had good outside experts and a lot of people in the state participated in joint physical care presumption. It's not something that came up as a solution to any problem. There are some solutions. Collaborative, of course, is a solution. People can think outside the box and do things that the court might not order. Parenting coordination is a solution. Parenting plans is a solution. Presumption favoring joint physical care is not a solution. And it creates a problem.
Jenny Darwin, the Dental Bar Association. So I'm just going to go over a couple of studies that we found in all the research on this. The first was that in 1979, California actually passed this law. 15 years later, they repealed it. After following a survey of California Family Court judges, that concluded that two-thirds of the judges determined that joint custody imposed under presumption led to mixed or worse results for children due to lack of parental cooperation, instability, ongoing parental conflict, and logistical problems. I also wanted to draw attention to, we're talking a lot about, without having this presumption, there's going to be more litigation. Well, a study done by Women's Law Center in 2003 in Maryland, they found that when the court ordered joint legal and physical custody, the subsequent litigation rates were the highest at 19 and 27%. It actually increased litigation instead of decreasing it. And that constant litigation is subject to childhood trauma and uncertainty as the child does not know what's going to happen with respect to this given issue. And finally, in 2008, Minnesota actually, the legislature required a study done, or interim study group. And during that, they looked at multiple disciplines. And at the end of it, they found that there was no conclusive evidence that a joint presumption was in the best interest of the child, and encouraged the legislature to keep the system working.
Hi, Cindy Gangston with the Iowa Judicial Branch. We are currently registered undecided on this bill. I just wanted to make clear that under existing law, the court already has to consider joint custody if either party motions for it. I just wanted to make sure that that came out. I heard some different interpretations about the current law. I wanted to make clear what the current provision is under 598. If either party motions for joint custody, the court is required to consider that person. Also, too, I do have the final report of the Family Law Task Force, and I'd be happy to share that with members of the committee. I can send you an electronic copy of that. As Diane said, there were many practitioners and other people involved in coming to those final recommendations that were provided to the board, and the board is working on implementing those recommendations. So, thank you.
So one thing under current code, if either parent asks for shared physical care, the judge has to consider it, and then the judge also has to set out the reasons why the judge decided. So I'm just curious as to whether you know or you've heard if judges are actually doing that. Because sometimes I hear these, you know, horrible situations, and I'm just wondering if you see decrees where it's spelled out, or is that not being done?
I think it may vary in district to district what a thorough degree looks like. Most instances, I think our judges are trying to provide a rationale for their decision, or multi decision and resolution. Obviously, it depends district to district on what that thoroughness may look like. So,
okay. All right, thank you.
Think that this legislation would help create a uniform standard for our judges to use?
In relation to what the final degree would look like, I believe that our judges try to live up to the standards that the law provides, and that currently I think that there may be variance across the state. I think that with any new law, there still may be variance across the state and what a final disposition order may look like. I believe that our judges do strive to include all of the rationale for their decisions and all of their final orders.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Cindy, I have a question too. This is quite, so don't sit down. Thank you. So do you know what the standard is for what's the standard for the rationale for whether or not to award shared custody or not? I mean, in here we're defining clear and convincing evidence. Is there a defined standard in code?
In code, currently the standard is best interest of the child.
A specific finding of fact in the motion that the awarding of joint physical care is not in the best interest of the child. So it's making a specific finding that it's not in the best interest of the child.
And I looked at the bar, I apologize, I don't have the code.
I'm sorry, and I just was wanting to know, because that's what we're trying to determine, how the court sees it, what basis or what threshold are they using in making that determination, if it's clear and convincing, or I can't remember the one below that, but providers of evidence, thank you.
been a long day. I just didn't know, so yes, that's what the best interest of the child, but then shouldn't there be a defined standard, whether it's preponderance or clear and convincing or something of that matter? That's my question.
It's actually test laid out in case law that the judges must comply with, that they go through that test, and it's preponderance of the evidence. They're looking at it and measuring it against the test.
But that criteria is set forth in case law, not necessarily in code. Is that correct? Okay, so case law is determining that's the preponderance is the standard.
I was
screened
for a case of Hanson.
Okay. Okay, thank you. That's answered my question. Thank you, Madam Chair.
If I may I ask a question as well?
I have a full committee meeting at 1:00.
Okay, so we've got 5 minutes, right?
I can make it very quick, and I apologize. So my question is I know I'm sorry, I was looking at her, I apologize. I don't remember your name. Sydney, I apologize. My question is I know you may have mentioned that it does have to be considered if it's requested by both parents. Isn't it also in there in subsection I that if one parent opposes, that also has to be considered?
Correct.
I would just like to add this. If parent was unfit on Monday.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Hi, thank you. I'm Laura Esper with the Iowa Coalition Against Domestic Violence. We are an organization that represents service providers that provide domestic violence services across the state of Iowa. We are opposed to this bill. We believe that presumption of equalized placement is bad for kids and bad for victims. Current law already directs courts to maximize time with both parents when consistent with the best interests of the child. And research shows that although shared placement is good for kids, a presumption equalized placement is not good and often disruptive. Having a good relationship with your child is just not the same as presuming you should have 50-50 shared physical custody. I am not an attorney, so I'm not going to try to answer the laws. I just want to point out that we oppose this because it sort of it substitutes a presumption for the factual evidence, and judge, we should reserve the discretion of judges to the facts of the case. That should be discarded. It flips this on its head. And only a small percentage, because the vast majority of custody cases are over So the small percentage that actually proceed to trial are ones where there is a where parents could not agree, and research is found that violence and violence is present. And so we believe this is very dangerous, and we want courts to be engaged and strive to do the best for kids. Courts should not have their hands tied. Every parent, we've never said, and I hope that doesn't come across that way, that this bill will increase incidents of domestic violence. It will be hard to increase them more than they are now, right? So that's not why we oppose. In fact, we believe parents who have been violent, we're not opposed to them having time with their kids. People change. It's just that when you flip this and vert it on its head, the default should be safe for the kids' mom. And if you presume 50-50 shared custody, you are putting that at risk, and you are allowing more opportunities for your people to continue to exert control over that spouse and not the kid right in the middle of that. And this bill is not a minor adjustment to Iowa's custody and placement law. It flips it on its head. And we're not opposed to shared custody, as folks have said, or shared physical custody. It's just that the default, the original starting point should be safe. And we learn the judicial discretion where it's important. If we're getting it wrong in some places, that's a judicial education thing. We can do that if we don't, put an overly simplistic fix in the law. And I thought that's it. So we have to see all the interactions.
We need to wrap this up. So I think rather than taking action on this right now, I think I will go over the information that I've received today. You can certainly email the committee and whoever else has further comments. I know you did too, had some comments. Please email those.
Thank you.
Thank you.